Welcome to the 13th meeting of 2023 in Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have no apologies this morning. Agenda item 1 is agreement to consider evidence in private. So our first agenda item is to do that. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you. The second item on our agenda is to take evidence on minimum core obligations with a focus on recommendations from the National Task Force for Human Rights Leadership. I welcome to the meeting this morning Professor Katie Boyle, who is the Chair of International Human Rights Law from the University of Stirling. Welcome. Alan Miller, Professor of Practice in Human Rights Law from the University of Strathclyde, and also co-chair of the National Task Force for Human Rights Leadership, and Dr. Elaine Webster, reader in law, also from the University of Strathclyde. And you are all very welcome this morning. We will, as colleagues, be asking you a few questions as we go on, but I would like to start by inviting Professor Katie Boyle to make a few opening remarks.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to the committee. Just as an opening remark, to commend you on undertaking this work, and thank you for hearing from us today. I'm absolutely thrilled and delighted to have the opportunity finally to talk to you, and thank you for your patience in that regard. Just a couple of points I thought might be helpful to say from the outset, and first as a caveat that when we discuss minimum core obligations, they can't be understood in isolation from the broader duty to progressively realise economic, social and cultural rights. So Article 2.1 of the Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights contains the duty, and MCO, or the minimum core obligation, is just one component of that. So all the evidence that I provide is with that caveat that it should be understood in that wider basis. And second, to say that both universal and relative minimum core obligations can apply, and they can apply concurrently. And effectively what the UN bodies tell us is that actually it's at the discretion of the state how to implement the minimum core obligation, with very clear guidelines on how to do so. But that means that both relative and absolute standards can apply, and that is what I would class a hybrid approach. And the third thing is to say is that other countries do this already. They use the social minimum concept. They don't always call it minimum core, and they often use dignity as a threshold as part of that. And indeed, we already use that threshold in the UK, and it's evident in jurisprudence, both across the UK and specifically in Scotland. So Scottish courts are already accustomed to using that concept in terms of the European Convention of Human Rights and also the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights. And just to finally, as a final point in terms of open remarks, is that often the easiest way to reflect on these types of obligations is to think about it from the rights holder's perspective and how they experience those violations and what it means in practice. And so my evidence will very much be couched thinking about it from that perspective, from the rights holder, how they experience a violation and how it could be addressed in practice. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Professor Miller?
Yes, thanks very much, Convener, and thanks to you all for your patience in hearing from the three of us. I know it's been a bit of a long wait for us, but we're now here, so I'm looking forward to engaging with you. I would just like to make a very few comments to maybe try and frame what hopefully we can provide for you this morning. I understand very much your choice of the minimum core obligations and respect that, but I also understand you've heard a lot about this from a lot of other witnesses, and particularly the Scottish Human Rights Commission quite comprehensively. And so I'm a little bit personally concerned. I may not have anything much further useful to add, but you'll be the judge of that. But as you said, Convener, I was the co-chair of the National Task Force for Human Rights Leadership. And so just to put it in some context, what the task force said, and it was half of one of the 30 recommendations about minimum core obligations, was that there should be a public participatory process in order to determine those minimum core. And the reason for that really was to ensure that the lived experience of individuals and their dignity was at the front and centre of understanding where that level should rest, and that really they are the experts in terms of the cumulative impact of whether it's housing or education or social security or employment, income or health, on their dignity of life. And so we were very clear that it should be a public participatory process and not some technical or managerial process alone. And recognising it's a cross-cutting issue. I mean, if you take, for example, women, very often, as we saw through the COVID experience, in the most precarious forms of employment, are the carers in many, many instances. And so to understand the gender dimension of it, it's important to hear from those people themselves. But as I said, it was literally half of recommendation 13 out of 30 recommendations. And the other half of that recommendation 13 was the need to, as Katie has said, couple an understanding of MCOs with also the duty of progressive realisation. And for a country like Scotland, that is something that is very, very appropriate, a developed country in the 21st century. So the continuous improvement and raising of the bar and not resting at the floor of MCOs. So the second thing, again, briefly, is, I think we all understand that there's going to be soon a public consultation paper, and then we expect that there will be a bill introduced to the Parliament. And I look forward very much, in that context, if you are interested, to engage with you to sort of understand how either the consultation paper or the draft bill aligns with the task force recommendations as a whole, and looking across the entirety of the bill and the entirety of the task force recommendations. And then finally, and just as an example of that, what was clear to the task force and what has become ever more clear since our report just over 2 years ago, and certainly personally, it's been my experience that it's the effective implementation of the bill that is going to make or break its value to people. And uppermost in that is the bill being accompanied by practical guidance and capacity building on a human rights-based approach to enable its effective implementation. That was reinforced by the recent publication of Scotland's National Action Plan, SNAP2, that may be on your radar. And the work I'm currently doing with the UN is leading work on development of an HRBA, a human rights-based approach toolkit for all UN country teams. So that's of this time, is the practical nuts and bolts understanding, particularly for public authorities who will hopefully have a duty to develop implementation plans, how they're going to give effect not only to the minimum core obligations but progressive realisation duties. So anyway, enough from me, and I hope I can contribute something useful, but just to put that doubt out there at the outset.
Thank you, Professor Miller. Dr. Webster.
Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you very much, convener. I'm delighted to be here. I would echo what my colleagues, Professor Boyle and Professor Miller, said about the duty of progressive realisation and minimum core obligations within that, and also about the importance of capacity building. I think something really exciting about this prospect of the legislation is that we can have participation that can then lead to hopefully a very sustainable piece of legislation. So I think it's really helpful for us to think long term about how we set the foundations for a better human rights framework in Scotland. My specific expertise is around the principle of respect for human dignity and the role that that plays in human rights law. And I contributed a paper on this to the Academic Advisory Panel for the National Task Force on Human Rights Leadership. The principle of respect for dignity, I think, is relevant in a number of ways to the things that you're interested in, including for thinking about minimum essential levels of rights and corresponding minimum core obligations. The National Task Force recommended that dignity should be included as a key value, included explicitly as a key value underpinning the legislation. Dignity is an idea that really captures the point of what we're doing. It really captures the purpose of human rights protection in law. It's symbolically very significant from the international human rights perspective and in line with that, but it's also practically useful to give prominence to this idea of dignity. In my briefing paper for the academic advisory panel, I noted the potential that this idea could be used to help support a sense of public ownership over the new legislation. And I've since followed that up with a small pilot project to explore that a little bit further. Dignity is relevant for understanding minimum essential levels of the right, if we look at that in relation to a dignity-based standard, that allows people to live a life in dignity or to live a dignified life. So therefore, it's also relevant for participation. The participatory process, I think, is a really, really exciting step in all of these discussions, especially if it will also include public authorities. It's really interesting for me personally, because I also do research on trying to understand how different people in different roles engage with human rights law. At the heart of lots of what we're talking about is, what do the rights mean? And that really has to be a fundamental first question that we ask ourselves. So it's a real opportunity, I think, to build broader understanding of human rights law. So thank you again, and I look forward to the discussion.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Webster. You have talked about the participatory process, and that's what I would like to start off discussing a little bit further and drilling into that. So it would be interesting to hear your views on how you think the participatory process should be approached. And I've listened very carefully to Professor Miller on the cross-cutting issues and including lived experience and putting that at the heart of it. So it'd be interesting to hear your views on that. Could I come to you first, Professor Miller, and then bring in your other two colleagues?
Yeah, I mean, I think, as I said, I've worked closely within the UN human rights system for many, many years now, and particularly since I end of term of office as chair of the Scottish Human Rights Commission. That's where I've largely been spending most of my time, and therefore looking back at Scotland and sort of contextualising where Scotland is in global terms on its human rights journey. And one of the, sometimes when you're in the midst of things in a country, you can't see the wood for the trees and appreciate what the assets and strength that you have in the country in comparison with the situation in so many other countries around the world. And one of the big assets that Scotland has, and has really come to the fore in the last 5 to 10 years, I would say, is the space for public participation in the formulation of laws, policies, and practice. And that's certainly what the task force mobilised, and our recommendations were based on, you know, wide participation, including very much those with lived experience, and hopefully that's why the recommendations will be, you know, closely looked at by those drafting the bill. So I think it's an opportunity for Scotland to demonstrate leadership globally as to how we go about defining the minimum core obligations through using this space that we have of public participation. And that means being innovative, by ensuring that the participation is meaningful, that it can actually influence outcomes and not be tokenistic. And I think there are lessons that we have been learning where we can ensure that that is the case. And never forgetting the purpose of public participation. It's not just to be seen to do the politically correct thing or the nice thing to say you've done or to tick a box. But it really is to get under the skin of what it is you're trying to make progress on. And the only way you can ensure that you are looking honestly at the progress needed and then be able to measure it is through basing it on the lived experience of people, because they are the ones who are suffering the denials of human rights or the inadequacy of human rights protection. And they are the best ones placed to tell us what progress we are then making with our best intentions. So involving those with lived experience across different aspects of life in combination with public authorities and experts who can provide technical information about where the existing standards and adequacy can be part of the evidence base. But first and foremost, is Scotland actually taking the opportunity to demonstrate leadership and building on the assets that we have in Scotland, which is the space which is denied in so many other countries?
Thank you for that. Dr. Webster, can I ask you about sort of like any ideas or thoughts about including the very people who we're talking about that Professor Miller referred to? They're often the most disenfranchised and furthest from any sort of like communication systems and difficult to reach. So what approaches can be taken? What have other countries done that we could learn from to make sure that those voices are at the heart of the participatory process?
I think in terms of participation broadly, there are of course lots of examples where we can look to other countries. In terms of what we're doing here in building understanding and understanding people's experience within the process of informing the implementation of human rights law is really innovative, world leading, I think it's fair to say. Normally when we look at the interpretation of rights, what they mean for people, often that happens in a very piecemeal way, often through judicial interpretation when it's too late to actually prevent rights violations taking place. So I think there's probably not a blueprint for what we're doing, but there is certainly, I have seen and I've been involved in lots of discussions with civil society, also to some extent with public authorities around the human rights framework as it's developing in Scotland. And there is a huge amount of innovation, creativity and expertise. So I think we're really in a unknown territory, but with all of the tools and resources and expertise that we need to do this. And I think I would reiterate how important this process could be for implementation, because the more people who understand the way that human rights law works and why it matters for them, whether that's from the perspective of lived experience or from the perspective of their professional role, and the more comprehensive as possible their understanding is, then the better position we will be in to achieve effective implementation now, but also in the future. So I think that it really is about building that capacity at the same time as really gaining those insights from lived experience. So I think it's a really crucial part of this process that we hope to see.
Thank you for that. Professor Boyle, could I ask you about what you think about the challenges with the participatory process? For example, is it possible that there might be areas of contention around certain rights? And we don't need to go into those rights. My colleagues will explore further. But I'm thinking about areas such as health, housing, education, and what is realistically achievable.
I think that's an extremely important point to raise. I don't think the aim of a participatory process is to, in and of itself, just reach a consensus on what a right means. There will always be most likely disagreement about the meaning and content of rights in different contexts from different groups of people. I think the purpose of the participatory approach that the National Task Force has recommended is to ensure that the voices of those with lived experience are given the level of expertise that they deserve, just like any other group would normally be in devising a new programme. And it will be difficult to realise that in practice, because as my colleagues have said, it's certainly a novel and innovative approach. But it's not the first time, as Elaine mentioned, that participatory processes have happened. So participation is an ethos. It's an ethos which is at the heart of the international human rights framework. From a perspective of thinking of it as an ethos, consensus building is an important part of that. But where consensus is not reached, for example, in deliberation around the content of rights, normally you would have processes and systems in order to help to resolve that. So in a system that, for example, a multi-institutional framework, which is the framework that's been proposed by both the First Minister's Advisory Group and the National Task Force, a multi-institutional system allows for deliberation between different expert communities in a way that consensus can try to be reached, but ultimately those bodies will take responsibility to give meaning and content to rights in different settings. For example, if Parliament introduces a new piece of legislation following the Human Rights Bill, there will be a part of that process where you will need to discuss the meaning and content of rights, for example, in secondary legislation. And that is a contribution to what is an ongoing deliberation, an ongoing conversation. What the participatory ethos requires is that people with lived experience have a seat at that table, that part of the consensus building and part of the ongoing conversation includes them, not in a way that is a consultation sort of framework. It has to be meaningful, inclusive, and it has to be equal. So that, for example, means taking into account intersectional barriers. Like you mentioned, some people will simply not be part of that system. They may not have engaged, for example, even with civil society groups that are already in that conversation in some respect. And so there is a lot of work to be done to ensure you have an inclusive model. And actually, Scotland is leading in that respect. The Scottish Human Rights Commission, for example, has already set up expert advisory groups, which include people with lived experience, in order to better understand what they see is needed from economic, social and cultural rights. And if you look at it from the rights holder's perspective, what you see in research that's undertaken is that people will be able to tell you what they need. They will be able to tell you when a violation occurs, and they're able to explain the nature of how that happens in practice. Our legal system and the framework for economic, social and cultural rights in the UK and in Scotland right now is not well equipped for that, but we do have the tools in order to change the system to fix it. So one of the big things that people will often say is that the issues they face are systemic, and they are clustered. So they won't just face one issue, they will face many at the same time. Often they will be experiencing other problems, such as they'll be living in poverty, they'll have intersectional problems to deal with, they may be facing barriers in multiple respects, and they will also have not only clustered but systemic issues. So it won't be just one individual that faces it, it will be many people facing the same problem. And in that context, what our system needs to do is better respond in a collective sense to provide collective justice and structural responses to those sorts of issues. So the participatory model is a way of making sure we engage at the start, from the outset, to better understand what problems people face, what violations look like, and how we might better fix them earlier rather than waiting, for example, for a court case to look at it.
Very helpful, actually. Just as a final question for myself, the concept of dignity, if you're talking about people with lived experience again, and a lot of people actually, they maybe don't have that concept of what is dignity. If they have lived without dignity, then their expectations are going to be different, if at all. So how would a participatory process make sure that the people with lived experience understand what is dignity and to live with dignity? Who monitors that? That would be, Dr. Webster, I think that's your question.
It's over many years I've worked with different groups looking at dignity. Student nurses, for example, have been a really interesting group to work with. There are remarkable similarities in how people understand dignity. This is also related to the small pilot project that I mentioned earlier that I did subsequent to the paper for the National Task Force, where I explored whether engaging with the idea of dignity could help support the growth of our human rights culture in Scotland. And I spoke to people working in civil society about their perspectives for themselves, but also for people that they worked with in the community. Dignity is an idea that people get. It's an idea that people understand. It is something that is recognised more in its absence than in its achievements. And that is something that's reflected in across a vast body of academic literature and in philosophical analysis, but also in social science studies for how dignity is experienced. But it is something that is very much intuitively felt. And I think its real power comes from the fact that it is something that people get. So people with lived experience will say they know what dignity means. They know what dignified treatment would look like. And it's essentially about relationships and relationships with people who provide services. So I think it would be a really important opportunity to recognise what people are saying about their experiences of what it means to have dignity violated sometimes on a daily basis. What is really useful here is that we would be asking these questions as part of understanding how human rights law can respond to those challenges. So it will always have an anchor in international human rights law and in the meaning and the role that dignity plays in that context. And I very much see that as part of the conversation that would happen within a participatory process about hearing what people say. And as I said earlier, there are remarkable similarities in the kind of ideas and things that people talk about when asked about that. But at the same time, it would be an opportunity to share understandings that come from international human rights law and to really understand how human rights law tries to respond to dignity violations in different ways, through different mechanisms. Different human rights respond to different facets of dignity. But all human rights are grounded in with the aim of protecting the dignity of human persons.
Thank you for that. Rachel Hamilton would like to come in.
Thank you, Convener. Just going back to the conversation there around the participatory process and engaging with civil society, we heard from witnesses that people feel marginalised within that process. It came through very strongly with people with learning disabilities, disabled people, and other groups. And I just wondered, it sounds great, but how in reality does this really work so that we bring everybody along with us in the process? Alan, do you have a...
Yeah, well, it's a challenge. It's not an easy thing to do. I mean, let me give you some personal examples. Yesterday I was in a community cafe in Dundee for those people affected by substance use, because I've been asked by the government to lead and chair a national collaborative for people affected by substance use as part of the National Mission on Drugs. And so I went to where they were. I didn't ask them to come to where I was. And I asked them what progress would look like in their lives and how it can be brought about. And so a whole day conversation. And what came out of that conversation is the same as came out with experiences I have of working in many countries around the world, particularly, I have to say, in Africa. And two things, I think, really strike me, that what you have to aim to get through this public participatory process. What I was being told yesterday, in the same way I've been told in many other countries and different parts of the world, is dignity is not something only that is contained within yourself. And so if you have a social security level of payment, that's enough. Or if you have certain housing standards, that's enough to meet your dignity is realised through interaction with others and through the ability to participate in a community and in the lives of the neighbourhood and your fellow human beings. And so dignity is something bigger than some technical sort of accountancy type thing. What's the level of income or adequacy of housing? It's a human universal need to interact with others. And particularly I found in the drugs context in Dundee yesterday, and it's the same in Glasgow and other places, is the demand from those that, you know, the so-called hard to reach is, see me. And it's the same you hear in Africa and different parts of, see me for who I am. I'm not a patient. I'm not a victim. I'm not someone who's looking for charity or some handout. See me as to how I've come to this place in life, what have been the factors that have led me to turn to substance use, for example, as a means of escaping the realities and the lack of dignity that I've had. And before you see me as a whole, don't make decisions on my behalf. I've got the right to participate in decision making. That's why this bill is so important, because it's going to bring in for the first time the right to the highest attainable standard of physical and mental health. And it's going to change the whole culture from, as an example, people affected by substance use bringing a self-stigma on themselves, sort of reflecting the stigma that society has, And so their own dignity is diminished. So they don't go to support services. They don't demand what they need in order to have their path towards recovery. They stay away and they become suffering from addiction. So dignity is interaction with others and seeing me for who I am and where I've come from in life and why I'm here and therefore what should progress look like and what role do I have, what agency do I have in determining the progress that's going to work for me. So it is, you might think it's a difficult thing, very abstract, academic. It's real, both in reality of community cafes in Dundee and in South Africa and Botswana and other countries that I've been working in.
Thank you. Karen Adam, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. Absolutely fascinating so far, and really appreciate what you said there, Professor Miller, because I think it's that disconnection and the feeling of disenfranchisement that really, if we can get to the core of that. My questions are going to centre around what exactly these obligations are and what they would look like in practice. Can I start with Professor Boyle?
Certainly. So, as I mentioned earlier, minimum core obligations can't be understood in isolation. They have to be read in conjunction with the duty to progressively achieve. So the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, like many pieces of legislation, whether they be at the international or domestic level, don't give a full elaboration of what duties or obligations mean. It takes subsequent interpretations of them to help us better understand. So the covenants from 1966, it was in 1986, and as part of the Limburg process that we had the introduction of the concept of minimum core obligations. And then the committee, which is responsible for the interpretation of economic, social and cultural rights, came out with a general comment to explain that it was the raison d'etre of the treaty and of the human rights framework that there should be a minimum below which no one should fall. And actually, regardless of what you call that, most people tend to fall in an agreement with that, using the concept of dignity often. And as I mentioned earlier, countries all over the world engage with this principle, with this threshold in different respects. So minimum core obligations should be read as part of the broader progressive realisation duty to take steps to realise economic, social and cultural rights to the maximum available resources, to avoid regressive measures, to ensure that substantive equality is part of that framework, and to ensure when things go wrong, there's an effective remedy. So there's a whole integral piece of machinery that works together. In terms of how they manifest in practice, what you'll see is you have to look at different sources in order to understand how that might operate in practice. So, for example, general comments actually provide guidance. There's a general comment in Social Security, which talks about the minimum core in terms of Social Security. There's a general comment on health, which talks about the minimum core in relation to health. And then other treaty bodies reference those minimum core obligations. So whilst the Committee on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights is responsible for explaining the interpretation of that treaty, you will also see, for example, the Committee on the Rights of the Child explaining minimum core rights in relation to children's rights, for example, have been very clear that regressive measures are not acceptable, even in terms of times of economic crisis for children's rights, and that there's a minimum core content to them. Or the Committee on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities have elaborated on what the minimum core means in relation to people with disabilities engaging in work and employment, and they explain what that would look like in practice, ensuring, for example, that there's no segregation in work practices, that people have equal access to employment opportunities and training, and that there's substantive equality included as part of that. Other countries interpret it. You can see in case law, if I just give a very brief example, in Germany, for example, they use human dignity as a value, but they use both absolute and relative thresholds. There was a case there which looked and said, look, the level of social security here falls below a social minimum. It violates human dignity, and the processes by which the state undertook to reach this threshold were insufficient, and so applies both in the context of that. Another example would be in South Africa during COVID, although again it wasn't specifically minimum core that was used. When as part of a national programme where children had access to free school meals, which is a very familiar story to us. The state stopped the free school meals during COVID when the schools closed. Now the South African Constitution protects the right to food, nutrition and children's rights, and they are unqualified, so they're absolute in nature. And the court looked at this and said that is a regressive measure and you can't justify it. So actually we're going to issue a remedy for all those children and they will all receive access to free school meals. And we want to see a report from the state explaining how they've implemented it. So in practice, the realisation is those children, 9 million of them who were not getting access to nutrition and food, got it, which is in stark contrast to the UK, where a similar story unfolded and we didn't have legislation to rely on to help protect in that respect. So it's just a different way of working in that way.
Okay, thank you. Can I come back in? Thank you, convener. Just what you're saying there, you know, what these are and what they look like in practice, it's bringing me back to yourself, Professor Miller, when you spoke about physical and mental health and that potentially being one of the core obligations. In terms of, for example, substance misuse, what would that look like in practice if that was implemented?
Well, we'll find out. I mean... We don't know whether minimum core obligations are being met in Scotland. You would assume that, you know, 21st century developed country, relatively rich in comparison with the rest of the world, you would assume it's a default position, you know, that minimum core obligations will be there, and then we focus on progressive realisation quite quickly thereafter. So I think it's an overdue scrutiny on whether we have been assuming things rather than looking for assurance that actually there are minimum core obligations. And it may not be as easy as we would want it to be because there won't be, I am quite confident, sufficient data across many sectors to understand just what the reality is. And that's why it's therefore important to go to those living in those real conditions to understand from them qualitatively where we are, because quantitatively we may not have the data. So I think it will shine a light on assumptions that maybe we're all making that minimum core are met, even though you would be entitled to think they should be met given the resources that the country has. So what it will look like in practice is, if you take substance use as the example you gave, I look at it very similar. I was involved in a really fascinating piece of work where I learned so much on the victims and survivors of historic child abuse. Very similar journey that I think we're going to have with drug deaths and trying to address that. And that is empowerment. The survivors of historic child abuse felt complicit in the guilt associated with what had happened to them, and so held themselves back from demanding their dignity and access to justice in whatever form that was appropriate for each individual. The same with substance use. This self-stigma, this acceptance of what society has said, that you are less deserving than the rest of us, therefore you're at the back of the queue, if you're even in the queue. So I think what we will look like is, at the end of a process of about 3 years working with the survivors of child abuse, there was a cabinet secretary who was in at the first meeting we had with the survivors when we were trying to begin a process of them empowering themselves, demanding their rights under international human rights law. And when the cab sec came back 2.5 years later to sign off the action plan that had been agreed by the survivors, by the religious institutions, the local authorities, he came up to me and said, "Alan, I don't know what's been going on here, but this human rights-based approach, about which I've been quite sceptical over the years, I admit, I can just see the difference it's made. Yes, these are the same people. I recognise the faces, but they're not the same people. They're looking at me straight in the eye, their shoulders are back, and they're expecting that I'm going to agree to respect their rights and sign off a whole programme of measures to enable access to justice for them." So it's dignity. Can we come back to that? Those people in that room, when they had become empowered and empowered themselves, you could just sense it, you could see it, you could touch it. They were human beings who were being seen for what had happened to them, where they were in life now, and what their future needed to look like, and therefore the responsibilities of the rest of us to organise the society that recognised that and fulfilled that. So the minimum core obligations are a floor. I suspect we haven't actually got the floor enough yet, and it's overdue that we're going to, for the first time, try and identify that. But we don't stop there. You know, it then has to be the progressive realisation of these rights and in a country that is as relatively wealthy as the UK and Scotland is.
Thank you for that. If I may ask Dr. Webster a question. I mean, in light of what we've just heard there, when we look at these core obligations, what would be your experience in regards to thinking that these should be universal or relative to each individual?
I think there are different ways of thinking about obligations, but I think it's helpful to think about the minimum essential levels of the rights, and the obligations are what we have to do in response in order to secure those minimum essential levels. So the minimum essential levels for each individual, I think that is something that we have to understand as well as part of the participatory process, because only by hearing from as many people as possible can we understand where do we set that minimum level. In international terms, there is a universal minimum that we can talk about, and that is because the idea of human dignity is seen as a universal idea. Dignity, I think, is a really powerful concept because it has enough content and intuitive understanding that we get what it is, but it also has enough flexibility and room within it that people can inject their own ways of seeing their own worlds and their own ways of seeing the world, really. So there is a kind of universal, but there is also flexibility, because it's a complex thing. It's about understanding how we as humans live in our societies and how we want to be recognised and relate to others. For thinking about minimum essential levels, I think in the participatory process, we can certainly, and it will be necessary to engage with the idea of a dignified life. What does that look like? That's part of what we want to understand. But I think we would be doing that, in my view. Well, there are different ways to do it, but one option is certainly to come to that process with a kind of working definition, if you like, of what a dignified life is understood to mean from the international human rights law perspective. And then we engage with people around that in relation to particular rights. So we'd basically be asking people what aspects of housing, what aspects of participation in cultural life do you think we need in order to meet that threshold of being able to live a dignified life? The minimum essential levels are the minimum. So we are talking about things that are very basic. We in Scotland have an opportunity to be a little bit more ambitious in what we see as the basic floor. But at the same time, we are talking about very basic things. So in that sense, I think it is likely that there will be a lot of similarity, because this is about very basic experiences at the end of the day.
Professor Boyle, can I bring you in, please?
Thank you. Yes, just to come in, I think that the question that you're asking there is an extremely important one, and also one that the international community, lawyers, judges and different countries grapple with. So it's important, first of all, that you've correctly identified it as an issue, and second, to take a step back from that, we have an opportunity to decide what approach should be taken. So, for example, if you look at how academics look at this, some will argue that there is a danger in trying to apply a relative threshold, because we should already progressively realise rights, and that there needs to be this bottom layer which is absolute, which is universal and which is survival-led, perhaps using concepts like human dignity, and that should apply across the globe. On the other hand, others argue that because different countries are at different stages and they have different prevailing circumstances, that is simply not sufficient in a country which can demonstrate it can go further in ensuring a universal minimum within its particular circumstances. There is the opportunity to reflect on adopting both. So an absolute minimum threshold would be one, for example, where human dignity is used as a concept to ensure no one falls below it. And we actually already use this type of threshold in jurisprudence. So, for example, the Napier case in Scotland was about applying Article 3 of ECHR, where it was considered that prisoners flopping out were subject to inhumane and degrading treatment, which is a form of looking at whether or not that was a breach of their dignity. So we see this, but what the threshold would mean in terms of economic, social and cultural rights is that we would apply that threshold at slightly higher level. So if you were to look at it from the perspective of what happens if there's a breach, how can a duty bearer respond? So what they might be able to say is, actually, we've taken these steps to apply a relative threshold. We have all the data, as Alan mentioned. You need to have disaggregated data to understand how different groups are experiencing a particular right. We've undertaken these steps. This is our minimum threshold, and we can justify our approach. That would be a relative threshold. Or you might have circumstances where there's just been an absence of thought or applied or the opportunity to apply a minimum, in which case you may need an adjudicator of some kind, whether that's a complaints mechanism, ombudsman, tribunal or court, to say, we recognise there was a minimum here that has not been reached. So, for example, where that disaggregated data has not been taken into account, and one group or community is simply not having access to basic food, shelter, sanitation, water. And unbelievably, in our country, this does happen today. In fact, the process that was undertaken when Alan was chair of the Scottish Human Rights Commission revealed major gaps in minimum core, what were obvious minimum core violations for particular groups who simply did not have access to things like heating, water, sanitation and housing. For example, the Scottish Gypsy Traveller community, there were people being accommodated in circumstances where those basic essentials were not available, which we wouldn't have known had we not gone through that process of gathering that data. I mean, obviously it was known to the people who were living that in that lived experience. So it's about trying to apply both thresholds simultaneously, if that's the approach that is to be taken. And you can reflect on the different types of remedies that respond to that. So, for example, a more basic level will require a much stronger intervention from an adjudication body to ensure that dignity is restored, whereas a relative approach might allow, for example, an adjudication body to respond to, have you really thought through the process here? Do you have the data? And if you don't, maybe go back and rethink that. So it's just different ways of responding.
Thank you. Okay. Pam Gosell, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel, and thank you so far for all your statements and all the information you've provided. And you may know this, obviously, that decisions are taken in local authorities are heavily influenced around Scottish Government budgets. So in that respect, if the local authority was considered to be in breach of any core obligations, but they simply had to make the cuts due to the ring fencing spending from the Scottish Government, who then would be responsible for the breach, and how, given the local authorities will be inevitably have different spending priorities, will that be facilitated between the national and local government? Could I ask Alan that question, please, first?
Well, thanks very much. No, it's a good, very searching question. We'll find out, as we said, with the public participatory process and minimum core obligations, we will find out the answers to a lot of these questions as we go forward. One of the things I've certainly found over the years is very much what you're raising, is that there's multiple duty bearers. And so when someone raises a challenge that their minimum core obligations, in their view, are not being met, we quite often will find it won't just be the one public authority that might well be held accountable for this. One of the benefits of incorporation of treaties, however, is that the primary duty bearer in a country is the state. So essentially, the state is made up of the central government, and then a whole range of public authorities. But ultimately, it is the state at the highest level that has the responsibility as the primary duty bearer. And it has the duty, therefore, in terms of economic social rights, to ensure that the maximum available resources are used for the minimum core obligations and the progressive realisation. So there's an opportunity through incorporating these treaties into our law of actually simplifying what for a small country can be a very complicated landscape as to who has the duty to do what to whom and in relation to what other public authorities. And actually a number of public authorities have told me when I was doing the task force work, particularly say in housing, that they would welcome a sort of clearer lines of accountability. And the same when you talk with, and again I'll go back to substance use just now because I'm sort of immersed in that that work because it's so so urgent. Frontline providers in local authorities or alcohol and drug partnerships, NHS, when you talk about this, the first reaction of some of them is, are you blaming me for the lack of minimum core obligations? I know I'm the sort of frontline provider. I've got limitations. I can't pull strings and levers to remedy this situation. And when they understand, no, that actually the effect of human rights law being brought into Scotland in the way that the bill is envisaged to do, the accountability will be going up the sort of food chain and at a higher level. Questions will be asked about the use of available resources, the priorities and budgetary decision-making processes. And so what I found is that the frontline providers and local authorities or health boards actually say, well, that's good, that's going to improve our working conditions. We're going to be able to deliver better services. And it's good that we are not the ones who are getting burnt out, who are also going to be challenged as being those that are denying minimum core obligations. So long way around, the central state as the primary duty bearer in sort of partnership with other relevant public authorities, they will be held to account
Thank you, Professor Allen. I'm going to come on to housing in a
sorry,
minute.
Sorry, can I just bring in Professor Boyle, who indicated...
I was going to come on to housing so that in a minute as well.
I think Professor Boyle wanted to add to your previous question.
I'll be very, very brief, if that's all right. Just
no, that's fine. Sorry, I think, Convener, you've got it wrong here. What I was saying is I'm going to come on to housing, but I'm going to stick with this question. Sorry, maybe I wasn't very clear. Sorry, Professor.
Thank you so much. No, I appreciate that. I just wanted... My expertise is in adjudication and access to justice, so I often go to the examples which involve courts, but it's just to help demonstrate what happens in relation to when things go wrong. And you raise a really, really important example, because people who feel they have duties to realise rights, who simply can't because the way the budget system works means they don't have the money, is important to reassure those duty bearers that the system has to accommodate those problems. And in other countries where this issue has arisen, and it does arise in the context of economic, social and cultural rights, as well as civil and political rights, I might add, because they are also resource intensive, what you will often see is that, as I mentioned earlier, issues are often clustered and systemic. So a local authority, for example, cannot meet a provision to provide a particular service across the board for everyone, so they're all experiencing this same violation. It comes to an adjudication body, whichever that one is. They will look at it, and in those other countries that have managed to try and grapple with this issue, the adjudication body will take in the various duty bearers and say, look, you're going to have to do this, you'll need to think about this, you need to work together, we need to come up with a remedy that ensures that this violation no longer occurs. And that's part of a structural response. So it's a different way of working than we are currently used to, but it wouldn't take a huge shift to adapt to that because we have all the tools at our disposal to do it. So collective issues, structural responses, including dealing with many different duty bearers. And there's excellent examples of that in the Colombian jurisprudence under the tutela system, in which that's exactly what the court has done. It's got all the actors around the table and said there's various different levels of government here. We need to work together because internally displaced people do not have access to housing, education, food, health, and we're all going to have to work together to find a solution. And then the court supervises that that actually occurs in practice as an example of how to deal with that.
Thank you, Professor Katie. Dr. Elaine, would you like to answer anything?
Yeah, nothing to add. I agree. Nothing to add.
Okay. Camille, are you okay that I ask my housing question?
Yes, please continue.
Thank you. Just on housing, in the last couple of sessions, we've obviously heard a lot on the housing emergency, as it's been raised quite a lot. And the sort of example to better understand that is what the core obligation would look like in practice around housing. So currently Scotland has a housing emergency, we all know that. We have record numbers of people living in temporary accommodation and many living homeless. And yet, obviously, a lot of the budgets by the SNP and Scottish Government have been slashed around this. So I wanted to understand what impact on understanding what impact on enshrining the right to housing into Scots law would mean in practice for the public authorities and for the Scottish Government, and what the implications would be if that right was not being met. Do you want to answer that, Professor Kate Farsia?
Thank you very much. The right to housing actually already exists in Scottish legislation, so it's a really good example because it demonstrates how, even although you have something in law, it doesn't necessarily mean it comes to be realised in practice, which is why you need that broader framework that's been brought through this Human Rights Bill, because you need the early stages of proper implementation, the support and participatory process, the work of Parliament to give content and realise rights, the work of government to implement it, and ultimately what you need is actions to redress when things go wrong. And I would argue that's where the problem is in relation to much of this. There is no proper access to justice avenue. Use of temporary accommodation is a good example of, for example, what might be considered a breach of a relative minimum core, because while people are being accommodated in housing, it doesn't necessarily meet the threshold in order to enable a dignified life when they don't have access to the various different components they need to participate in society and exercise their autonomy. Likewise, the problem around, for example, evictions is people are often underrepresented in the justice system. So they will, for example, face an eviction notice, turn up to deal with that. It depends if it's private or public housing. It'll be either in the sheriff court or in a tribunal. And they'll be unrepresented, where the landlord might have lawyers on the other side. So it's an access to justice issue where there's no equality of arms. And then finally, homelessness. You can present, for example, at the local authority to say you're homeless and under the Housing Act, which is an act which has been recognised internationally as a really key important act, because it's not based on priority need. Everyone's entitled to protection. If you suffer from being able to exercise that right, you have to raise a judicial review, which is very costly and not something easily can be done on an individual basis, which comes back to that issue of clustered and systemic problems and trying to respond to them in a more structural and collective way, ideally without the need to go into court. Nobody wants to go to court. That has to be there as a backstop, but it's about trying to change the system to respond to those systemic issues you raise in a more comprehensive way.
Thank you, Professor Katie. Dr. Elaine or Professor Allen, would you like to add anything to that?
Just very briefly, I think what international human rights law demands are really good faith attempts. And all of this has to happen within the ethos of how international human rights law works. So around participation, access to remedy, all of these things are part of a big package, which should hopefully... what we want is for human rights violations to be brought to light. And once they are, then the processes are in place to try to address those in a way that recognises that, you know, implementing human rights, whether it's civil, political rights or economic, social, cultural rights, is not always a straightforward process. But the point is that there is a plan, there is a time-limited strategy, there is communication, and there is a coherent and collaborative effort to prioritise, whether that's strategic decisions or through budgetary decisions, to remedy those things in the appropriate way. So I think that's just useful for us to bear in mind that it is about good faith attempts and that communication and collaborative, contentious processes, but in a respectful way. I think that is reassuring. I think part of the process is really reassuring public authorities in every sector, and we've also seen this in some work that we did looking at the right to housing as a case study in Scotland. There are concerns around basic things like, you know, housing stock, how can these things be overcome, but it is about bringing those to light, about prioritisation and about good faith attempts.
No, thank you. So, Professor Katie, you mentioned the Colombian example. Can you just say a little bit more about that?
In the interests of time, thank you.
I'm very happy to follow up with that example in writing, if that would be helpful.
It's fine. If you could follow up with an email, that would be great. Thank you.
Happy to do so.
That would be great. Rachel Hamilton has indicated, but just before I bring her in, just following on from Pam Gosell's questions, obviously sort of like governments come and go, but the policies that they implement can have far-reaching effects. We've recently been taking evidence on asylum seekers and refugees, and some of the evidence that we have heard is that, like the illegal migration bill, for instance, some organisations have said that that is a breach of human rights of asylum seekers and refugees. And we have been looking at sort of like the tensions between devolved powers being able to mitigate the perceived harms. So how would this fit in with that context? I wonder if Katie's nodding her head, so I'll take that as an indication of a comment.
It's to agree that it is a very difficult area in terms of managing reserved and devolved competences and how far one can go to try and address and mitigate, and it applies across many reserved areas. Some of the research I undertook over the past 5 years on an Nuffield study spoke with practitioners about the different types of violations of social rights that people experience, and this area recurred time and time again. And so all in response to that, one thing is to recognise that in terms of devolved competence, it's important to take a maximalist approach, which is at the heart, and I would defer to Alan to speak about that further. It's at the heart of what all the recommendations are in the National Task Force, to go as far as it is possible to do so within devolved competence to try and address those gaps. And there will be many areas that are cross-cutting, but using the power to observe and implement international obligations that the UK has signed up to is a power which is devolved to the Scottish Parliament, and it's within that power that you can go as far as you possibly can. But it's also a really important example because the UK Supreme Court, at the time the House of Lords, intervened in immigration and asylum cases when it was felt that there was a risk of falling into destitution, and they applied a minimum to ensure that people did not fall into destitution. So it's an excellent example where in the UK we already apply a minimum core in the context of immigration and asylum. Now, it's complicated because it doesn't apply across the board. It has to be in particular circumstances under the particular piece of legislation that applies. But the European Convention of Human Rights was able to step in and provide a floor in those circumstances. So also a good example in that respect.
No, that's very helpful. I was thinking about the right to work, of course, because we're not in the right of asylum seekers and refugees, because not all of them have that right to work. Yeah. So that's what I was thinking of. Could I bring in Rachel Hamilton,
Thank
please?
Thank you, Convener. Professor Ball, it was just to pick up on the response you gave to my colleague, Pam Gosell. On various parts of articles within UN obligations, such as the liberty and right to live independently in the community for disabled people, or perhaps rights where children and pregnant women are concerned, there is already a conflict between a minimum service obligation and those rights. How does this kind of human rights approach help an individual who, for example, if I use an example in my constituency, a young man with learning difficulties who has a place at a college but doesn't have the ability to have supervised travel or the transport to get there? So in a practical context, we know that the articles are already being broken within the rights of individuals. How is this approach going to help that person?
Again, an excellent question, and perhaps one in terms of in the current circumstances, there may be pieces of legislation which would already support that individual. I know, and for example, legislation relating to social work and social work responsibilities include, for example, accommodating needs for different circumstances following an assessment of that person's needs, although I wouldn't speak to that person's particular circumstances. But what an act ought to do, and we don't know yet because we don't have the act before us and we don't know what it looks like, but in terms of the UNCRPD, it does, as you say, provide various circumstances to help support people live independently, and what that act might do then in these particular circumstances is help that person participate in that college course in the way that they wish to do so. The problem that you identify is how do you go from, well, this is what's happening to this person, where's the remedy? Like, where do they go? And that's the part that we don't have an answer to yet because we haven't seen the act. What people in those circumstances normally say, and perhaps your constituent will offer his own preference in that, is around they often don't want to go, nobody wants to go to court, nobody wants to have to raise a case to get access to basic needs. But our system, which are non-judicial routes or non-legal routes, are not well equipped to deal with this right now. So what we need to see is a step change. And what the recommendations say is, and what Elaine and Alan have spoken to, is this is a culture shift. So whoever has responsibility for helping support that person would reflect on a human rights-based approach in order to help them participate and live independently and be able to use the treaty that provides for that right to help support that change. And if they're not able to do that, for example, for budgetary reasons, then you need to take a step back and work out how the budget's been spent and whether or not the money's been allocated to its maximum available resources, addressing all the different components of progressive realisation, minimum core, and so on. So there's a decision-making process to go through in order to reach that end.
Thank you.
Thank you. Paul O'Kane.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel, and thank you for the contributions so far. I suppose we started to touch on some of this, but I'm particularly interested in how we monitor and scrutinise those minimum core, essentially. And I suppose I'm interested from our point of view as to Parliament's role in that and where the panellists feel that there is a role for Parliament. Should there be some kind of scrutiny at committee level in Parliament of organisations meeting their minimum requirements? And I think we've heard something about local authorities, for example, in that space. But I think crucially, the Scottish Government itself, you know, who holds the government to account in terms of whether it's meeting its obligations or not? And I suppose linked to that is, what would you see as the indicators you would want to measure, you know, the government or public bodies against? So I appreciate it's quite a wide-ranging question, but just keen to know what our role should be.
Professor Miller?
Yeah, I'm happy to come into that. It's a good wide-ranging question, and it was one that the task force spent a lot of time considering. And we took the view that for the effective implementation of the Human Rights Bill, there had to be what we call a multi-institutional approach. So it was a combination of the government and public authorities, the courts and the Parliament, and that the Parliament had a very, very important role to play. And within the Parliament, your committee has a very important role to play. So one of the recommendations we made from the task force was that the government should be under a duty to present to Parliament its own implementation plan. I think the language was a human rights scheme to implement the bill. So what practical measures was it taking to give effect to these rights and to make them real in people's everyday lives? And for that to be presented to the Parliament for scrutiny and for accountability. And one of the components of that human rights scheme to be presented to Parliament by the government was that implementation plans from all public authorities should be required by the government to ensure that there was a uniform, consistent implementation of the bill. And again, therefore, Parliament would have an opportunity to look at those reports from public authorities and from the government itself. And in terms of indicators, the recommendation was that there should be human rights-based indicators of the progress made or not in implementation of the bill, and that these indicators should be co-designed, that those with lived experience should again be part of a participatory process with public authorities to define what are the realistic human rights-based indicators of progress. So again, for example, the work I'm doing in chairing this national collaborative as part of the National Drugs Mission is that we are developing a charter of rights based on the incoming bill for people affected by substance use. And we will co-design between alcohol and drug partnerships and those seeking to use services, agreed measures by which progress can be monitored and evaluated and lessons learned where sufficient progress is not being made, so that Parliament has a role to oversee all of that and to hold the government and public authorities to account. And within that, the task force looked at different countries, and one of them was Finland, and the very important role that, broadly speaking, the sort of your peers there in the committee system in the Finnish Parliament had a very, very respected role within the Parliament. For example, when legislation was being introduced to Parliament, they would scrutinise it and make a view as to whether it was compatible. With our case, it would be with the Human Rights Bill and the international obligations. And that committee's voice was very much respected because it was based on very good authoritative evidence base from, you know, human rights experts. But in this case, you could supplement that with evidence from those with lived experience and therefore be a very clear authoritative voice within the Parliament and strengthening the role of the Parliament to hold the government to account.
I don't know if anyone wanted to add in. I mean, that was very helpful, Professor Miller, in terms of an overview. I suppose I'm also, I mean, absolutely, this committee and the committees of the Parliament have a role in terms of the scrutiny, in terms of, I think, looking at legislation to ensure that it's compatible. I suppose part of my question is what happens when targets aren't met and standards aren't met? And is there a role? Because very often in a parliamentary democracy, because of the nature of majorities, it can often be difficult to enforce, if you like, if I can use that expression. I mean, is it a sense that the courts would be the place where much of that would be done rather than this Parliament? Or do you think there's a role for a commissioner within Parliament or the Commission, the Human Rights Commission, to have those sorts of powers of redress, I suppose, or dealing with significant issues when they arise?
Well, the task force recommended different levels of accountability from different processes and institutions. So at a local level, you would hope to be able to resolve issues quickly and effectively and in as collaborative a manner as possible, so that the decision-making at that ground level was based on human rights. And then secondly, if that didn't work, and we all know with the best will in the world, it's not always going to work, then the scrutiny bodies, the inspectorates, the ombuds institutions, they would monitor, and their job would be made easier because of the duty on public authorities to develop implementation plans, their commitment as to how they're going to give effect with progress indicators. So the scrutiny bodies should be better placed to scrutinise the human rights performance of public authorities. But if that fails, and we know no system is perfect, then there needs to be access to a judicial remedy. But there again, a kind of improved approach can be developed, and Katie is the person to pick this one up, that the courts should be able to provide a remedy that where they see something systemic that is simply not working, and it's not just this individual or that individual, then they should be able to look at that from a systemic point of view and consider a number of remedies we recommended, what's called a structural interdict, that the court would take the view, look, this system is not designed or being implemented or even monitored in a way that has an outcome of those rights being realised. Therefore, we will suspend judgment in this particular case, but give you a reasonable period of time to come back showing us that the system is going to remedy itself in a way that is compatible with rights, and we will then look at that to see whether we think that's the case. And within that, there's a role for the Scottish Human Rights Commission, which we recommended, that it should have the enhanced capacity to take test cases if it sees something systemically not working the way that it should be. So it's sort of multi-institutional approach, but front-loading it, very much what we call the everyday accountability sector, should be as effective as possible, but a backstop to the courts, which should also have a better way of systemically addressing issues and making sure that the structural changes take place, and avoiding the burden being felt by individuals having to take on the world simply to get something that they're entitled to way back down the food chain.
What if Professor Boyle might want to comment?
I agree with everything Alan said, and I'll not repeat. What I would say briefly is what your question essentially relates to is about access to justice, and it's important to reflect on the fact that access to justice in international human rights terms, and as would apply to this bill, means access to an effective remedy. And an effective remedy needs to be adequate, it needs to be affordable, it needs to be timely, and it needs to be effective. There needs to be a realistic prospect of reaching an outcome which addresses the violation. And at the moment, we don't have a system that accommodates that in relation to these rights. And so in response to your question about where is the appropriate avenue, all avenues need to be exhausted, and you need to irrigate the system so that all avenues are available and that all justice routes are recalibrated for these types of rights in order to try and meet that threshold of an effective remedy. If a particular route becomes an additional barrier, it is no longer effective. So if it takes too long, if there's not sufficient advice to support people, if they cannot reach an outcome which actually addresses the violation, then that route is no longer effective. It needs to be changed, or it essentially doesn't meet the threshold of what's required. So the Parliament is one avenue through which justice can be sought, and so the Parliament should reflect on all the different means through which it can help support that. There is an example of the Ombudsman, for example, having a power to refer to the Parliament when it notices a systemic issue. I don't think it's actually been used in practice, and the Ombudsman's current remit needs to be recalibrated for these particular rights, but it would be a potential route and also could work concurrently with those other institutions of government. So the idea being that it's a conversation and deliberation between all of us in all our different capacities in order to try and reach a redress for the person and people who experience the violations. So it's just to reframe the way we think about justice as access to remedies, wherever that may be.
Yeah, Kinder, that was very helpful, I think. I wonder if I might just briefly on international examples.
Yep.
Professor Miller mentioned Finland, which was very helpful, but I think for this committee it's useful for us to reflect on where this has happened elsewhere in the world and perhaps what the outcomes have been. I know in the documentation we've seen Germany, Belgium, Switzerland, Colombia, Brazil, and again I think a variety of ways to access justice in those nations. But I wonder if there are other examples that you think we should focus on?
Well, I'll have a go at that. I think, you know, you've already sort of cited examples that the task force looked at very closely. But I often get asked this, you know, is there some model country somewhere in the world that we can just lift something off the shelf and apply here? And the blunt answer is no. Every country has its strengths and weaknesses and is on a journey and has its own history and culture and tradition and ways of doing things. So you really have to take responsibility yourself as a country to chart your own course within international human rights law and learning as much as you can from other countries. But taking responsibility yourself is something that is, I think, needs to be recognised. And also taking advantage of, within the UN human rights systems, there are mechanisms and tools available to concretely support countries take a path forward in accordance with their own ways of doing things. And as I say, I work very much within the UN human rights system, so that you've been talking about indicators before. There is a tool, for example, that we have developed and is being increasingly used by countries very effectively. It's called the Human Rights Matrix. And what it does is, you may or may not have heard of the Universal Periodic Review. It's where every country's human rights record and performance is viewed by its peers within the Human Rights Council. And it's based on information that comes from the countries themselves, from the UN human rights system, from civil society, and it then issues recommendations to that country. And the matrix is a tool that the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights has developed for each country. It takes these recommendations, which are all based on treaty obligations, clusters them into thematic areas so that you can sort of translate them into what terms you're more familiar with, aligns them with the Sustainable Development Goals, where the crossovers are very, very relevant, and then enables parliaments, governments and civil society to track the progress and implementation. And this is a cycle, like every 4 to 5 years, countries are held to account. And so the progress indicators are very much there in front of their peers that they will be held accountable for as part of this cycle. So that there's ways and means within the UN human rights system that you can use the mechanisms and tools to add strength to your own way forward, learning from other countries, but also leading and taking that responsibility of leadership. And in Scotland, in comparison with many other countries that I've worked in, really we have the responsibility, because there is so much space within Scotland to have these sorts of discussions, to do innovative things, to break ground and actually take a leadership role that other countries can not copy us, but look with interest, as in fact they are in many respects. So, we should look to ourselves and use the international human rights system and don't sort of think, can we take something off the shelf from Finland or Colombia? We can learn a lot from there, but take responsibility ourselves.
Thank you, Convener. Very grateful.
Thank you very much. just before we come to the end of our session, I just wanted to pick up on a couple of points that we've mentioned already. Going back to remedy and justice, that's going to look different for different people. For some people, absolutely taking a court challenge is the route that they wish to explore, but it may be that a remedy would require non-legal routes as well. So I'd be particularly keen to hear from the panel on what their thoughts are on what kind of non-legal routes would be open for people that wish to challenge any breaches. Could I start with Dr. Webster, please?
Yeah, I'll just say something very briefly, hand over to Katie again on remedies. But I think what's really important, it's a point that's been mentioned already, is that we think about how we can support decision makers at every level to take the every relevant right into consideration at the point of delivery, at the point of making decisions. And that's really the first important thing where we need to start. It's all part of one big puzzle, but that is a really key part of the puzzle, is thinking about how can decisions be made at point of delivery that are with the best intentions, human rights aligned, or human rights compliant, if you like. Even within an organisation where people are able to make complaints through the normal complaints avenues within any organisation, at that stage, those making those decisions should be thinking which human rights are at stake here. That is their burden to identify what issues are relevant here, because in any particular instance, a person might face, as has come up already, multiple issues, which could mean multiple rights are implicated. So therefore, and we can't expect individuals to come and with a list of rights that have been violated. So it really is about building that capacity into decision-making and in internal complaints processes. And from there, then we start to go ombudsman and then we branch out.
Thank you. Professor Boyle, please.
Thank you. I'll just mention again the importance of using effective remedy, access to justice, as it's termed in international human rights law. And that means effective processes as well as effective outcomes. So if we go back to what I said at the beginning, if you think about this from the perspective of rights holder, and you will see this with your constituents, often what people seek and what research tells us time and time again is when something happens where people experience a violation of their dignity and a right, what they want is an apology. They want it to stop happening. They want the issue to be fixed and they don't want it to happen to anyone else. And that happens to... Now, we have a system which is very individualised in nature, relying on individuals bringing cases, which is really difficult for people in very precarious circumstances. It doesn't account for the clustered nature of the problems or the systemic issues. We rely on them, place a huge burden on the individual to raise a case, regardless of it, whether it's legal or non-judicial routes. And so we need to change that way of thinking to allow collective responses. But ultimately, regardless of whichever route is available to be taken, it needs to meet that threshold of being effective in nature. And at the moment, that's not what's there. Actually, what we know from research on access to justice is there are multiple barriers people have to overcome, even to use non-legal routes. So if we go back to the start and think about this from the perspective of undergoing a journey, something's happened to me. I know it's wrong, but I don't know what to do about it. First of all, people need to have awareness of their rights. They need to have legal consciousness of the fact that the rights exist and they're entitled to them. They need to have awareness of the processes and knowledge of the system. And that needs to be supported with resources, financial, legal and emotional, because it's not fair, as I say, to place the burden on one individual. Often what people will say, for example, in the mental health sector, is that they use collective advocacy in order to raise issues. There's a fear of retribution of an individual raising a case, and they use this collective advocacy system in order to bring problems before various different authorities. There needs to be an issue in resolving the complexity of the system. Ideally, yes, you would be able to go to an ombudsman or a tribunal, or just to a complaints body in the service that you're working for, but they need to be able to respond effectively and be able to issue an effective remedy. Also, people don't realise that sometimes if they pick one route, they actually can bar themselves from taking another, and there's not enough known when you engage with that system or enough support at the moment to help people navigate that. So ideally what you would have is proper advice and co-located services. So rather than asking people to come, for example, to see a lawyer, you would ensure that advice providers are in places like libraries, schools. Unfortunately, the proliferation of food banks is where people go who experience clustered problems. There should be support and doctor surgeries. Those are the types of places where you go to help support people. When the Act comes into force, it will recreate a transformative system in which these rights actually take on legal status. So that will enable routes to effective remedies. But all of these non-legal routes need to be supported in slightly recalibrating and changing their system in order to respond to the particular types of rights and the nature of the violations. And that is through collective advocacy, collective cases, an ability to ensure that they are not hindered from taking another route, and always as a backstop, ensuring that you have access to a court as a means of last resort, as overall supervisory body. And finally, in that time of clustered approach, or when you're responding to something structurally, the importance of moving away from an individual case basis is that people aren't looking for compensation. They genuinely want their situation restored. And often that's a fear that you'll create some kind of litigation culture. But it's about actually trying to address the violation itself and help restore people to a place where they should have been, avoiding the administrative mud of getting stuck in a system, which will not actually even be able to give a remedy at the end of the day, and ensuring that we change things to enable our systems to respond differently. So that means wider definitions of standing, different types of tests than we currently use. We need to have a broader reasonableness test to assess and interrogate compliance with rights, ensuring that we can, as I say, respond collectively and structurally to problems, ensuring that ESC rights is a grounds of challenge and that can be raised in different places, perhaps a bit like a devolution issue, which can be raised, for example, in lower courts, which can then refer up. Say, for example, an issue comes up and a tribunal says, we actually don't know how to respond to this, that they could refer it up to the Inner House for a response, those type of things. So there's so many different mechanisms that we can do to ensure that we basically open paths to justice for people and move away from this individualised approach.
So flexible and adaptable.
Yes.
And responsive. Get that. Rachel Hamilton,
comment,
please.
Comment, actually. Thanks, convener. It's just, as I've been listening, it's dawned on me that, you know, we haven't considered geographical inequalities or the ability to deliver within public bodies. And what you're saying is definitely not a silver bullet, and any of us, because we haven't explored this enough. But I do think there could be inconsistencies in the, the outcomes or across Scotland because of that.
Even in relation to, for example, the advice sector that I spoke about there, what you see in practice is there is advice deserts. So depending on where you live, you may or may not be able to get access to the help you need, for example, in immigration and asylum support or housing support. If you live closer to an NGO or a charity that might help support you, or you're able, if you have digital access, you might be able to get support. But that's what the minimum core comes back to again, because essentially what you're trying to do is look at disaggregated data to understand where those gaps are. If you don't have that data, you don't know who is further from those structures and who can access them, and always reflecting on the fact that many people have not engaged with the system. We don't actually know how bad things are for some people. And so it's about trying to ensure that we are not walking into it with our eyes closed. The more data that we have and disaggregate it across those intersectional barriers, the better we can understand where those gaps are.
Thank you. Just as a final question, I think that I'm going to go for Professor Miller, but if either of you feel that you need to chip in, please do indicate. How do you think that we've talked about sort of non-legal routes, but going back to the courts, how do you think courts might be able to judge cases, given that we have difficulties in defining what the scope of minimum core obligations might be? Will courts have sufficient experience or skills to be able to do this? What does the system need to provide in order for them to be able to do their job in that case? Professor Miller?
Yeah, when you said you were going to go for me there, I was getting a bit concerned. But I can handle that, yeah. I think there's a couple of things. Our courts are already becoming more skilled than perhaps we realise, in that they do engage to some extent with international human rights law already, and having sort of had conversations with the judiciary in one way or another over decades. The last couple of decades since the Human Rights Act came into effect has broadened minds in the legal profession, including the judiciary. And the composition of the judiciary has also been broadened to some extent. So they would quite rightly say, this is an area that we have some experience in, you know. Plus, why can't we become as skilled as any other courts around the world? You know, we will raise our ability to take into account international human rights law if that's what the Parliament wants of us, and we quite confident we can do it. Why could we not do it? We can, you know, look at other courts and look at jurisprudence internationally. We can look at the general comments from treaty body committees. So yes, it will be a new challenge for the judiciary in the same way as it will be for every other institution, but one that they should be able to rise to, and therefore I think they have an important role to play. directly answering your question, how can they sort of interpret or define whether a minimum core obligation has been breached or not? In part, this public participatory process of defining the minimum core obligations will be very helpful, because that will give them a measurement, a tool to look at. The implementation plans from public authorities is something they could look at to assess and scrutinise as to whether that's adequate and compatible with the duties that public authorities have. And if we have easier routes of access to justice, that cases can come before brought by bodies on behalf of a whole range of individuals, and interventions from other bodies with expertise. So if we sort of loosen up the system a bit, then there'll be other sources of evidence that will be made available to the judiciary to take into account and to help equip them with these judgments. But we probably end where we began. If a judge is sitting there saying, well, I've got this source of evidence, I've got that interpretive authority, and we come back to human dignity, and the courts ultimately may well come to judgments based on, I've heard everything, I've seen all kinds of evidence. Is this something that is enabling this individual to live a life of dignity or not? And that will be the final sort of criterion that the courts will have to apply in the way that other courts have begun to do that as well. So we come back. Maybe you should give Elaine the last word on that, yes, because that's where we come back to.
Webster.
Thank you. And I just wanted to say, yes, I agree, and I don't think that should be concerning either. Sometimes there's a little bit of trepidation around the idea of a dignity standard, and I think that's because we all intuitively think we know what it means, therefore everyone else must know what it means, and that's probably different. But actually, it's not something that I think should be concerning. So courts around the world work with the idea of dignity. Dignity is an idea that is found in most written constitutions in the world, so it's very commonly used. It is familiar in Scotland's legal culture as well, I would say. So in the briefing paper that I did for the academic advisory panel, there was a section on dignity in Scots private law because of the way that Roman law has been received into Scots law. And on that basis alone, I would say that it is familiar in our legal system. We also looked at the use of dignity language by courts across the UK and found that it comes up in thousands of cases across all jurisdictions within the UK. So it's not something that is unfamiliar. And it's also language that we find used in legislation, including there are examples of legislation of this parliament as well, which uses, including recent examples, that use that legislation. It's also been mentioned that courts use a dignity standard in adjudicating on the prohibition of inhuman and degrading treatment in the European Convention on Human Rights, which has been in our legal system for the past 20 years, directly alone. So it is familiar. And so I think we'd be in very safe hands if we have to get to that final point of a court making a decision on that basis. Because at the end of the day, it is about ensuring as much as we can that people are enabled to live lives and the way that they want.
Thank you very much for all of that. It's been a very interesting and formative session, and it seems quite fitting to end on a final note talking about dignity. And I would like to, on behalf of my colleagues, thank the panel for their contributions this morning, and I bring the public session to a close.